I am Brent Heyning, and I run a company called ToyShoppe Systems. We've grown out of inventing things, taking things apart, then getting chased around the house from mom after I took apart things. You know, it's a long story. But anyway, got into the movie industry, and as things develop and you find that you really still like tinkering, we decided to go ahead and get a company together and start that up. It's true, I did bring two helmets from Tron Legacy, the last Tron movie, not the 30 years ago, but I brought in two real helmets from that were actually worn in the movie, and that was kind of exciting. So what I had for Tony asked me to come in and do a little larger than a 5 minute, 10 minute thing. So what I want to do is bring up the situation that, we tend to work in partnership with a lot of people, and I have brought for you tonight, today, whatever, it's hard to see, a few extra people from people that I partner with frequently and are absolutely amazing builders in their own right. So we have Anouk Viprik. Down here, come on up. It's time. Heather Vesant. And Mike Elizalde and Brian Walsh from Spectral Motion. These people are amazing builders and I love working with them. So going back to the brief thing about the Tron helmets, this is one that I didn't bring, so it's kind of a treat for those of you who were in New York. This is Sam Flynn, the main character. You can see the concept art, and then I took a, there's a picture of what it really looks like inside under the foam, or under the skin cap thing. There's all the circuits and the lights and everything else involved, EL sheeting and LEDs. Another project we just got done with a little bit ago is Destroyed. This band from Canada, there you can see, right, this might be working. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I will. The top picture, you can see a side picture. Down below, you can see them fully lit up. Each of them over 700 addressable LEDs by the light board back there, wirelessly walking around. And I think I have a video really quickly here. Oh, wow, laser pointer that works. Yay! So this is... oh, it is. Awesome. Anyway, this is just showing some costume pieces real quick, like. Some lighting going on around there is all color addressable. I work with Anouk on a project for Eurovision 2012, was it? Yeah, for Austria. Involved color changing as well. Thank you. It's kind of, the taste of the music's maybe not for everybody, but this is a brief. You can see they're bouncing around for almost 100 minutes solid. There's no breaks in between. They just go. You can see different aspects of how they shift and move from CO2 and other blastings. And it's all wireless. They're not connected to anything. This one we had to connect because the liquid CO2 does different things. Crazy, huh? So... this was in San Francisco, so. Yay, fun. So that was, yes, again, at the Warfield. We also did several other big projects going on that involve Heather with, she's gonna talk about some really great stuff, and with, you see the two characters over here, which they'll talk about. So I'm gonna push ahead on that one. So we can do the video. Video switch. Everybody, I introduce you, Anouk Viprik.
Thank you so much. Okay, I hope I'm understandable. My name is Anouk Viprik, and I'm a Dutch fashion tech designer, so I merge fashion with technology. And I'm going to take one moment to install myself here so I can play with this thing. I try to blur the lines between the human and the technical, mechanical, and engineered. And next to this, I'm also the curator of an exhibition about electronic couture called Techno Central, where fashion meets technology. This happened 2 years ago in Vienna, in Austria, at the Museumsquartier, and I'm planning this for next year to bring it to San Francisco during May. And the exhibition is exploring, it's exploring both the adoration as critical as the critical elements that come to mind when you combine fashion with technology. The Vienna exhibition, it featured 31 artists who were or a fashion designer or engineer or an coupling together through the artist in residency program of the exhibition. And that's what I wanted to say about that. As an artist, I have a background in fashion design, in interaction design and engineering, and I combine microcontrollers and sensors with different different effects. And they are mostly special effects based, because I like to play with that. And that is where me and Brent met, I think it was, 2011? Mm-hmm. Or 10? 2011. We did the Super Bowl. Actually, I had a different outfit than Brent was on. I was doing the lead singer, Fergie, and Brent was doing the male, the boy.
Will I Am.
Yeah. Will I Am. Thank you. this was fun to explore. We created this chess piece for her with high power LEDs because the Super Bowl is super bright and you can't come there with your LED strips. And this is a little movie. It's also a good test because I should have sound by now, but.
This was interesting because there were four people on stage and each of them had a different designer and constructing. Honestly, the best outfits that worked best for the performers was the one that Anouk built with Fergie and Will I Am. They were the only ones that could actually dance. So I was like,
win. Yeah. So that was a fun project. What I learned from that was that from working with performers, normally I work with models, and working with performers, it's interesting because you have two kinds. The kind that wants to have electronics on the body to just do something, like they want to have it just command and on and whatever. And you have other kinds of performers who really want to play with the interface that they have on their body. For example, to name Björk and Imogen Heap, you give them something and they want to play with it. So that is that's interesting for me, because interaction is really important. I hope to give you some more insight into the creative process of what happens when you merge fashion with microcontrollers. I think I have 10 minutes, so I might have to go through it very fast. Technology I use as an instrument on the body that takes on a part of our expression through communicating in a non-verbal manner with the world that surrounds us. And this is interesting in many ways because it's an ever ongoing set of exploration. So for me, it's maybe not necessary the future fashion that I'm trying to create. It's for me really the research into the space that we have around the body and the interaction that we can create with it. For example, this is the Dairdroid. It's a cocktail-making robot dress that I created in 2010 for an exhibition called an event called Robo Exotica. It's based on cocktail-making robots. So I started with this idea to make a dress. I did it in collaboration with two fellow artists, Jane Tingley and Maddie Skintel. And what it does is it has sensors. It has just simple infrared sensors in the neck piece. It's connected to the back system, which is a customized board from a project that I used before. And as soon as you come into the personal space of this design, it gives you a shot of non-alcoholic liquid. So, for example, cranberry juice we use a lot. And it's an interesting design because it doesn't stop there. It's not that you just give get a drink and you're done with her. You need to play a game in order to catch your alcohol. So she asks you, she comes up to you and she's asking, like, do you want to have a drink? And of course you want to have a drink because she's gorgeous. And as soon as you say yes, you have to play a touch screen game of truth and dare with her. And if you if you answer this correctly, then the system is giving you the alcohol. I bet. So this is a little shot. You can see the videos online. So it's all there. So yeah, in a way, I create sort of these interfaces that I see. I don't know. I see fashion as a big interface, and I like to have these interfaces to become a tool. And within interaction design, the intimate space of the wearer is not that often explored. And I think that's fascinating. That's one thing that you can pull off really, really easily. Like with projects like this, I like to create new kinds of dialogues between our bodies and their surroundings. So this is the smoke dress. It's a dress that covers the wearer in a thick layer of smoke as soon as you step into her personal space. This is already the 3.0 version. It's the third design. First design is created with Adouan Dariba. And the first two, actually. And now we have a 3D printed smoke dress. Because that's the cool thing about fashion. Like, I don't like the fashion system that much because it's an ever-changing thing. Sort of every half a year, you need to reinvent things and your old collections are being thrown away. Whether my designs, sort of, I update them and I upgrade them. And because of that, they only get better. I work with this according to my sensors. It's based on the proximity theory of Edward T. Hall, in which he defined public space, social space, personal space, and intimate space. And that is how my sensing system mostly works, and also my research is based on. So this is a little bit the effect of the smoke dress. So I needed a really big push sort of according to the smoke coming out. So it's something that I've been busy with since 2009, and I finally got it all settled. This is a little prototyping movie where we showed her in a museum at the exhibition Hybrid Skins of Melissa Coleman in the Netherlands at Tatum, which happened last month. So there she was seeable. The dress is created in collaboration with Materialize, who are great according to 3D printing. It's a Belgian company, and it was created for Volkswagen as part of an 8-piece collection during the IAA. The dress is, I got modeling assistance from Italian architect Niccolo Cassas. So this is how we created the dress. This is the main shape, all sleeked out in Keynote. But this is one of the renders. And we had to investigate how to use. It was all new to us to use. Normally, I use 3D printing for making casings and such things, like not to print dresses with. So we used TPU, which is flexible material, and we used a sort of modeling weaving technique, which made the dress to be flexible. So that was the outcome. So what I'm doing, I summed it up because sometimes I don't know. I'm investigating other ways of using fashion and on-body technologies than physical. So I'm interested in emotional, intellectual, psychological, and sensual levels, and also the sensory experiences. So how we can perceive things differently through on-body systems, creating a higher connectivity of the senses through the medium of clothing, using sensors to generate and use data from both the body as its surroundings. And what I do is I create robotic structures on the body that utilize technology as extension of our capabilities. So basically, I use the sensors, things that we exist with, as sensors, internal and external, and I couple them to my designs. I use my controllers mostly. I use the basic ones to prototype with. For example, TNC, like it's the smallest TNC 3.0 that I use. And from there on, you can check out to create customized boards or whatever the needs is. But mostly, it's pretty simple. This project, because what I want to point out, material is really important to me. This is PDLC foil. And it's a foil that you electrocute from to sites, and it's creating this transparency. It's a really fragile material, so what I always do is try to screw over the material as much as possible and to see what it doesn't want to do in order to know what it does want to do. So this is how you can see when electric field is applied and when non. So it's just big cheese. These are the two states of the dress. I just skipped through it. It's a product for Studio Roosgaarde, which is an interactive design company in the Netherlands. I'm sure that some of you have heard of them. It's a project from 2010, I think, in collaboration with V2, Institute for the Unstable Media, where I did a summer session. My work is known for having an instinctive and territorial character sometimes. This is the last project that I will be showing, because I got a note here. It's a funny project, a robotic spider dress. Thank you. And it explores, it explores again like personal space and how to how to get a sense of that. It's a dress with mechanic spider legs that can twist in 9 degrees, so it has 9 degrees of freedom. And it's as soon as you step into the personal space, then it starts to react on you. So in the public, in the social space, it's just happy, it's dancing around, and as soon as you're coming into the public space, then it starts to notice you and attack.
Time now for the Black Widow edition of Weird Planet. Now, I don't know about you, but some people really have issues with personal space, right?
Really?
So if you get too close, I would be wearing a dress like this. Take a look. This is a robotic spider dress.
It's gonna have like 30 more seconds.
Yep. 6 robotic limbs protrude from a black dress, crawling around your body. There are 6. We know spiders have 8 legs, but it's a dress. Get over it.
Yes, it's a collaboration between fashion designer Anouk Whipprecht and software engineer Daniel Schatzmeier. It's this wearable dress that's equipped with sensors that interact with the people around you. If they get too close, those legs will come out and just push them away.
Yeah, so it's not just weird legs moving around randomly, like if you strap the giant 6-legged spider to your back.
Hey, I would love to wear that dress at a bar.
Yeah, I don't know how that would go over for you, because the people who would come up to talk to you might not be the people that you're most excited to talk to back. I mean, you might really need it for the person's
face. No, exactly. It'll be fun.
Okay, so the point of it all go down. Technology combined with fashion can create new ways of communication between people, a new relationship between interface and the body, and new connection of the body with technology. For me, it's a playful exploration where the body becomes even more the platform of interaction in both expression and as communication due to the symbiosis with technology. The position that technology has in our society, which I see a little bit to please us, we'll get more and more intimate, and technology crawls closer to the skin. And as technology crawls closer to the skin, we will need to start to rethink and recreate the relationship that we have towards technology. And I think my thing is that I try to curate these experiences. Thanks.
Yay, thank you. It's hard when you do so much trying to cram it in such a tight little space. So
I know.
Thank you for putting up. I'd like to quickly, Heather.
Thank you. So I'm Heather Schlegel, and I'm a financial futurist. This is a really fun conference. Most of the time I go to financial conferences, so this is really fun. And actually, a lot of the stuff that I look at is the future of money and how we're going to pay for things. We're going to set this up to show the video, right?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Just want to make sure that we're ready. So,
switch laptops, please.
One of the things that I look at in trends on how we're going to pay for things is with wearables. So we've looked about wearables with health and technology and medicine, and these are all really obvious things, but how are we going to pay for things? And so, okay, great. Yeah, no, I can probably.
Okay,
that's cool. We dealt with that. So how are we going to pay for things? And with wearables, this is kind of a new idea. And my work bridges a little bit of reality and fantasy as well, because as a futurist, I have my work rooted in trend analysis and research with what's happening today, what's really happening with the technology. But at the same time, I'm looking at what the future could be, what these possibilities could be. If we extrapolate these ideas based in reality, how could they be expressed? And so when I do these future scenarios, what I call future reenactments, I use movie magic to show what we can create. So I'm going to show with you today a very short film. I've made a few of these. This is about 2.5 minutes, showing how, actually, this is 2 years old, so you're going to see stuff in here, and you're going to think, oh, man, this doesn't seem that futuristic. But it was, like, the research was done 4 years ago, and it was scripted and written 3 years ago and shot and released 2 years ago. So yeah, let's play Fly Me to the Moon, and then I'll talk a little bit about some of the specific wearables.
I love that.
Is it like maybe hit the...
Not permitted. That was my little, one of those things, is it?
Yeah, you like it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah, Brent was like, and we'll have
No, we played so before.
I told me he had, it was counting from 0 to 15, so I said to Brent,
oh,
like I told you, still had
to but we need sound. We're missing sound. I mean, I know the script. Sure.
You see it rising. You see the colors it leaves behind.
I'm so jealous. You should make me your co-pilot.
Not a chance.
Oh, well, was everything?
Everything was great.
Delicious.
Great. Is there anything else I can grab for you guys? Just a checklist.
Thanks.
So how are we gonna do this?
Hey. Does anyone have change for this?
So you'll notice there are a couple, there's transactions happening here. Not all of them are wearable transactions.
The good old days.
Jason,
you might find it interesting.
Cash in the good old days?
Well, cash couldn't do this. Roast chicken, 2 Jack and Cokes. And the best thing is, it's totally anonymous.
That's what they say. I'm not so sure. I still worry about who might be tracking this information and what they might be doing with it.
No, here, let me get this. You got the tickets earlier.
You sure?
I insist. I rarely get to see you, at least in the flesh. Thanks for picking up the wine, guys.
Sure.
Our pleasure.
Interesting. Our waiter has asked to be tipped in Blue Orbit credits.
I can take care of that. You've seen our promotion?
See the sun like you've never seen it before. Suborbital sunset.
Wearable transaction.
Looks like our waiter's seen it too.
When do you go back up?
2 days.
We all good here?
We're good.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Enjoy your trip.
Heather has some of the props from this over here at the table.
I will say that this whole idea came out before Virgin Galactic had their save up enough Virgin America, Atlantic, and V points to win a suborbit spaceflight. This was prior to Virgin Galactic being so successful with their suborbit work. You can shut that off. So I'm wearing the jacket for Claire, the space captain, and in this short, the wearable transaction is with her badge here. And what she's paid for, she's paid the tip in Blue Orbit credits, which these are based on a concept of frequent flyer miles. And without getting into the whole financial reasons why this would exist, certainly if you have questions about that, come talk to me afterwards. The idea is that there's a technology that you use as a piece of corporate branding that can easily be detached and used to transact with devices, whether there be hardware or software. And I have some more props over there too. In another one of my short films, the second one after this, we're not going to play it, called Flowers for Grandma, I have a device that is basically, for all practical purposes, is a Bluetooth-enabled bracelet that you can talk into, and it automatically pairs and connects with your mobile phone or whatever, and you can make transactions through vocal verbally. In my research, so these are ideas that I came up based on my research that don't exist. They're movie magic. They're ideas that to inspire how wearables could be used with financial transactions. I do want to mention 2 financial transaction mechanisms that do exist today. A couple months ago, maybe 6 weeks ago, a company came out called Glass Pay. It's using Google Glass to be able to, you wear it, go into a store, look at the barcode, it tells you how much the price is, and then you can actually pay in Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is a new cryptocurrency that is being experimented with in the financial space. Like the idea for the bracelet that's paired to your device, another company came out. They just raised over $100,000 on Kickstarter called the MEMI. It's a specific device targeted towards women. It's a bangle bracelet that pairs with your iPhone, and it actually looks like a real bracelet that I would wear. I've always said I will never wear wearable technology unless it's beautiful and functional and like a piece of jewelry. So if you've got questions for me about using questions about wearables with financial transactions, I'd love to talk to you. If you're interested in how to make any of your ideas in film more based in reality from future's perspective, I'd love to talk to you too. And Brent and I work together on the props on these projects. So amazing man, this guy. So thank you.
Thank you, Heather. And so we also have, along with the two guests over here that stumbled in, we have Michael Izzaldi and Brian Walsh from Spectral Motion today, trying to squeeze in. So we're good.
Awesome. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Brent, for inviting us to be a part of this event. My name is Michael Izzaldi, and I'm the president of Spectral Motion Incorporated. And this is Brian Walsh. He's the project manager at our company. And what we do is we create prosthetic makeup effects. We create creature suits, animatronics, and we're branching out a little bit more into robotics technologies now. We are also exploring how our science and art is applicable in the fine art community. And we've done a couple of projects now. I can't talk about one of them yet, but it's pretty spectacular. The Brent has been intrinsically involved with that process with us. So what I'd like to do is turn it over to Brent for a minute to show some video so you guys can get a full scope of what exactly we do. So if you don't mind, Brent, go ahead and play it. That's the character that you're seeing over on the side of the room there, Mr. Wink. Most of our characters that cover the actors' faces do have facial articulation, and that performance is actuated either by a group of puppeteers via radio control, remote control, or through a control system that connects to the character. It's the kind of thing that utilizes every discipline of creative and technological expertise, and it's a very, very fun process for us to create characters like these. Because we're able to attract people with the technological know-how like Brent and also our lead designer, Mark Strachian, we represent a company that excels in animatronics. There are some filmmakers out there who are leery of this kind of technology because they've had bad experiences with it in the past. Our company boasts of a flawless record of delivering performances, never keeping a crew waiting, and
what our company
has been able
to achieve is the culture realism, the attention to detail.
Anyway, so the point of telling you that is that we do rely heavily on technology to build our reputation, to be able to deliver characters that perform time and again, and will actually feel like they're emoting in a scene and really carry a scene for a director. That's my wife and me. We started the company in 1994, and we became an independent studio in 2002, I think it was.
Is that right?
Yeah.
To be able to take the information that we find in a script and to be able to articulate that to our team, to be able to create the designs that the director's looking for.
So this is a very different brand of wearable technology. The people who wear this technology are really special individuals who are incredibly athletic, incredibly resilient, and out of their minds, because these devices are, you know, by any definition, they are torture devices. They're you know, it's difficult to see, it's difficult to hear, and you have to deliver a performance that's believable time and time again. So we do rely on a group of actors who this is their field of expertise. So that kind of gives you a little bit of an idea of the kinds of characters that we design. And we really constantly reach out and try to expand our field of technological resources. In years past, most of the characterization or the effects that we've created are created by using cables to move them around. And in recent years, we've started, relying more on radio frequencies and newer technologies that are emerging. We just had a really interesting conversation with a gentleman who presented a very small package that contains sensors, accelerometers, I believe, and that will give us the ability to make a very low-profile suit that can be worn to control characters like those. Or characters like we built some hydraulic robots for a show called Robot Combat League for the Sci-Fi Channel. And we used actually telemetry suits to operate the robots. In this new system that was introduced to me today, that wouldn't be necessary. You could just put somebody in a bunch of sensors and have them virtually fight with each other while the robots tear each other to pieces. So lots of cool stuff happening. Brian, you want to say anything?
Actually, you want to talk about Johan for a little bit?
What are we doing?
Johan.
Oh, that character over there is called Johan. He's from Hellboy 2, Guillermo del Toro's second Hellboy movie. And the idea behind the character is that he is a gaseous entity. So he has to have sort of like a diver dance suit to contain himself and be able to function among human beings. The suit was created entirely by us. So it sort of speaks to the question of, well, what can you do there at Spectral Motion? And the answer is we can do just about everything. We can design costumes. We can design articulated elements for costumes, not unlike what we've seen today. Although I have to say, your stuff is amazing. Sorry, I never had a chance to see it before. So we do take a lot of different, challenges that are unusual for us, and that always keeps our job very interesting. So I think, what else have we got, Brent?
Well, so all the smoke that you saw on him, all the smoke externally was CG, but the smoke in the helmet, the smoke that comes out of his little goggles, that's all practical stuff. Those were all little smog devices we had hooked up on here. But I think more importantly, not only do we have wearable tech here, but I think a lot of the stuff that was presented here is actually relative to some of the stuff we do. Some of the, like, wearable temperature gauges would actually be great for creature stuff suit we do, because you can't tell if they're uncomfortable, they're encased, you don't know. Also 3D printing technology, and also 3D fabric is stuff that we've integrated into our pieces before. So I think a lot of the fields kind of cross over, not only stuff that we do here, but stuff we can use from you guys would be really great.
It's true. It's very exciting for us to be here because there's things floating around out there that we were not aware of and that we're learning about today that is directly applicable to the sort of work that we do. And it opens up a lot of doors of imagination. I think, unless you guys have any questions, I think we're finished, are we? I'm not good at wrapping things up, so.
Just remember that we live in a world where you can dream your existence into reality, so dream well. Thank you.
Brent, thank you. That was awesome. Okay, Brent and amazing crew. Thanks. That was great. What? You have a question? Okay, well, we can sneak a question in.
Yeah. No idea. Yeah. I think everything can be accessible if you try hard. So.
Actually, they're getting to the point where they can print cars. They can print a lot of these characters. We just worked on a project where a lot of the character parts were all printed, including all the raceways, the interference pieces and parts, and they were all done to full spec. So the matter of printing your clothes, I'm sure Materialize and some other people's are coming up with them. The cross-polymer Stratasys is a good example that company has machines with multiple materials, and the machine mixes what type of materials, and you can make any kind of durometer or any kind of other fabrics. So it's coming.
I've seen a couple years ago, someone was doing some 3D printable bikinis. This was before the 3D printing technology was really more widespread. But I think that probably some of the challenges with 3D printing clothing, you might be able to print shoes or accessories a little bit easier, as is the whole fabric situation. But it's really interesting to hear how fabric has certain technologies overlaid on it through the washes. That might be a really interesting, like when, as manufacturing expands in that area, to allow those kinds of more fabrics in that area, you can see those things maybe kind of 3D printers being able to handle some small pieces of it.
Okay, we're going to have to actually wrap it up at this point.